So earlier this year, I won an international science fair. And ever since then, a bunch of people have been asking me, how on earth could a 15-year-old have developed a new way to detect pancreatic cancer? My response, a year and a half of hard work and over like millions and millions of failures. It was pretty depressing. But so recently I developed a novel paper sensor for the detection of pancreatic, ovarian, and lung cancer. And this sensor, what's so cool about it, is it's 168 times faster, over 26,000 times less expensive, and over 400 times more sensitive than the current method of detection. The best part? It costs 3 cents and takes 5 minutes to run. And so it all began one day when I was researching on online statistics about pancreatic cancer. And you might ask, why on earth would a 15-year-old be interested in pancreatic cancer? Shouldn't he be interested in video games? And what actually got me interested is a close family friend who's like an uncle to me had passed of the disease. And what I found on the internet was eye-boggling. What I found was 85% of all pancreatic cancers are diagnosed late, when someone has less than a 2% chance of survival. The average survival time is about 3 months. And so there's a demographic of about how 2% of people will survive. Now, I was wondering, why are we so bad at detecting pancreatic cancer? I mean, a society as advanced as ours should have already been able to detect this long ago. And what I found is that our modern medicine is a 60-year-old technique. That's older than my dad. And also, it's grossly inaccurate. It misses over 30% of all pancreatic cancers. And in addition, it's pricey. It costs over $800 and it's not covered by your insurance plan. And so it's not an option to lower income patients. In addition, it's rarely ordered because pancreatic cancer is what we call a non-symptomatic disease. It doesn't show any symptoms. Usually they're just like really random symptoms like abdominal pain. Like who doesn't have abdominal pain sometimes? And so then what happened is I thought there has to be a better way than this really crappy technique. And so then I started setting up a scientific criteria. How was I going to detect pancreatic cancer? I mean, I was a 15-year-old. And so what I said is it would have to be inexpensive, rapid, simple, sensitive, non-invasive, and then also selective. And so then I was researching and I began to realize why we haven't been able to detect pancreatic cancer. What I found is that what you're doing is you're looking for this tiny biomarker, a protein that's found in your bloodstream. And this sounds really straightforward, but it's anything but. See, the problem is that your blood, it's already abundant in protein, and you have liters and liters of it in your body. So finding this tiny increase in this tiny amount of a protein in there is next to impossible. And then what I realized is that what you're trying to do is kind of like find a needle in a haystack, only worse. It's trying to find a needle in a stack of nearly identical needles. Now, from there, what I did is I began looking at my search online, because what other source does a 15-year-old kid have? So I actually started with a database of over 8,000 different proteins. And I just started chugging through these, and luckily on the 4,000th try, I hit gold. I finally found this one protein, and I was next to insanity there. And the protein that I found was called mesothelin. And it's essentially your ordinary run-of-the-mill protein, unless you have pancreatic, ovarian, or lung cancer, in which case it's found these extremely high levels in your bloodstream. And then the key here is that this protein is found in the earliest stages of the disease, when you have close to 100% chance of survival. So if you could detect this, you would barely have to worry about your cancer then. And so then I started shifting my focus to how I was actually going to detect this protein. And it came in the most unlikely of places, my big breakthrough. High school biology class. It's stifling of innovation, terrible. Now, what I did is I kind of smuggled in the scientific article on these really cool things called carbon nanotubes. And it was like under my jacket and I was reading it under my desk. A carbon nanotube, you might wonder, what on earth is that? It's essentially a long, thin pipe of carbon. And it's 1/50,000th the diameter of your hair, and it's an atom thick, so extremely small. But it has these extremely amazing properties. It's like the superhero of material science. Now, Just as we were learning about, or just as I was learning about these while I was reading the paper and their amazing properties, we were learning about these things called antibodies. And antibodies are these super cool organic molecules. They basically attach to one protein and only that protein. They're really particular. And it's kind of like a lock and key molecule. Now, I was scrolling around this concept. How could I connect the carbon nanotube's amazing properties to how this antibody reacts with only a protein, in this case, the cancer biomarker mesothelin? Then it hit me. What I could have is this antibody. I could put in this network of carbon nanotubes such that it would react only to the specific protein biomarker, but also what it would do is it would change its electrical properties based on the amount of protein present, so much that I could measure it with a $50 ohm meter that I got from Home Depot. And then what I did is my biology teacher, she spots me. She's like an eagle here. And she storms up red in the face. And she's like, what are you doing, young man? And snatches it out of my hand. And after class, I finally begged with her to give me back the article. And she eventually complied. And that was really all I cared about from that experience. And from there, what I did is I started refining this really cool idea I had. And then what happened is I need a lab space because I can't do cancer research on my kitchen countertop. And so then what happened is I wrote up this idea, I made a materials list, a procedure, a budget, and a timeline, and I emailed it to 200 different professors at Johns Hopkins University and the National Institutes of Health, basically anyone who had anything to do with pancreatic cancer. And they kind of expected that I could sit back and just relax and wait for the positive emails to flow in and me get accepted into a lab. And then reality took hold, and I got 199 rejections out of those 200. And one lukewarm maybe, and that was kind of downheartening. But then what happened is I pursued this maybe professor, and 3 months later, I landed down a date with him, and I go in armed with the 500-plus journal articles I've read. And what happens is over the course of the interview, he keeps calling in more and more experts, more and more. They keep firing more and more questions at me, trying to pop a hole in my procedure. And actually, I was kind of prepared for this because one of those rejection emails, the professor systematically went through each of my procedure points and slowly ripped it apart, saying how each and every one of them was a mistake. So I was kind of prepared for this. I had a study guide. And then what happened is I finally got the lab space I needed. And then began on this 7-month-long journey. And as soon as I started, I was expecting, oh, I'm just going to chug through this and be done in 3 months. Actually, it turned out to be 7 months. Because as soon as I started, millions of mistakes started coming in. I realized my procedure wasn't as perfect as I had initially thought. And also another valuable lesson I've learned from this is that nothing is as simple as it seems on paper. And from there, what happened is I painstakingly filled each and every one of those holes that in my procedure that I had found. These include like blowing up my cells in the centrifuge, killing my cells, then killing proteins, and then killing my carbon nanotubes. I seem to be killing everything. But eventually, at the end, I ended up with one small paper sensor that could detect pancreatic, ovarian, and lung cancer with 100% accuracy. And through this, I learned a very important lesson, that through the internet, anything is possible, that theories can be shared, and you don't have to be a professor with multiple degrees in order to like have your ideas valued. It's just your ideas that count on the internet. And being brave and being fearless here, to me, is that you don't have to use the internet in conventional ways. We don't really need to see your duck face pictures on the internet. Instead, you could be changing the world with the stuff you do on the internet. So if I had done all of my research on Google and Wikipedia, and I'm a 15-year-old, imagine what you could do. Thank you.